working. We had to make sure the sound was working, so trying to start this on time. I basically want to say thank you for everyone that's here. Anybody who's done events, so it's not always easy to get people to a panel discussion, but what a panel. So thank you. My name is Maria Cornelius. I am the president of the East Tennessee chapter of the Society of Professional Journalists. Obviously, a lot of people in this room had a lot to do with this, especially Georgiana Vines, everybody, Catherine Luther. A lot of people have put a lot of hard work into this. These are our very esteemed panelists. Their bios were behind me, but I'll go ahead and read them to Alex S. Jones, of course, Pulitzer Prize winning author. I saw a copy of your book. Someone already has it in here, so that person is prepared. Also, historian and an SPJ Foundation board member. Jack Needley is on the end of the table. I think everyone knows Jack Needley, but he is the Knoxville historian, knows everything, and the executive director of the Knoxville History Project. And Dr. Michael Martinez is in the middle. He is an assistant professor at the UT Journalism School, UT School of Journalism and Electronic Media, got that at UTJEM, and a media historian. A huge thanks to the UT Journalism School of School of Journalism and Electronic Media, for they are videotaping this. It will be on a YouTube link, and we will send that out so it will be able to be watched later. I do not know if Ms. Walker and Ms. Sarah Jane Schwarzenberg, did they make it to this event? Okay, they're in the back. I want to thank you both for coming. They are ancestors of Adolph Ochs through his father's sister's side. So they connect all the way back to him and have traveled here for this event. So thank you so very much to both of you. I know you're not up here to hear me talk, so I'm going to step away. We are here to hear our panelists talk. When they are done, I'll come up and announce to everyone. I'll come up and announce to everyone where we're going to go afterwards. So everybody enjoy this, and thank you so much.
Well, I'm gonna start this off. I'm very honored to be between the two of these gentlemen to talk about Adolph Ochs, and we're gonna start out with Jack Needley to talk about how Adolph Ochs got in Knoxville in the first place, and you know what his participation was here in Knoxville. So, Jack, if you can.
Thanks, Mike. I've given a full hour talk about this subject before. I'll try to collapse it somewhat, but it's a pretty fascinating story, and it says a lot about Knoxville, and I think it also says a lot about Ochs, the Knoxville part of the story. I want to remember, though, I was 35 years ago, I was an assistant editor for Whittle Communications, which some of you may remember was a magazine company, unusual magazine company here in Knoxville. And we were ostensibly doing national work and very little historical. But I worked with, they hired nationally, and most of the people I worked with were much better educated than I was in journalism. They had, many of them had studied journalism formally at major institutions. And they came here, and they were fascinated with a plaque that they saw on Gay Street that I'd never heard any Knoxvillian mention before. And it's a plaque indicating where Staub's Opera House was. And I don't know if you are familiar with this plaque. It's still there on the side of Plaza Tower. But it says Staub's Opera House was built in 1872 by a Swiss immigrant, Peter Staub. And then just kind of out of nowhere, if you read it down, it says Adolph Ochs was an usher here during his first year. And most Knoxvillians would read this and say, so what? Who's this Adolph Ochs character? But these people at Whittle Communications who had studied journalism, they said, what? They looked at this and said, what was Adolph Ochs doing in Knoxville? And they would ask me this question, and I became the token Knoxvillian on the staff at Whittle, and I began looking into this. And I actually have Adolph Ochs to blame for my peculiar career, I think, because I began looking into the history of my hometown about at this moment. But I looked into it and found out that their assumption that Adolph Ochs had come down here some summer vacation from New York to serve as an usher at Staub's Opera House, that was not exactly right, that this was his home at the time. He lived most of his childhood in Knoxville. And how he got here is a pretty fascinating story. His parents were both from here. They were both Jewish Bavarian immigrants. But that was about all they had in common. They differed about almost everything during their interesting lives. Julius Ochs was from Bavaria, but connected to aristocracy. He had an uncle who was a baron, and so he was sometimes sympathetic with the status quo in Germany, with all the princes and barons in power. He was a well-educated guy. Came to America in 1844 or 45, depending on who you read, and either seeking better, greater opportunities or due to the arrogance of the German military. That was one story without further discussion that I've run across. He joined the army in America, served as an accountant during the Mexican War, and then gravitated over toward Mississippi, where he met a woman named Bertha, who was also a Jewish Bavarian immigrant with a very different story. Bertha was an anti-aristocratic rebel. She had been involved in the rebellions of 1848, the revolutions of 1848 that she heard about that was when Europe was really, Central Europe was very unstable, and there were these democratic revolutions among people who wanted to make Central Europe as democratic as Western Europe was. And she was, as a teenager, was involved in leading much of this rebellion. She had, there's a wonderful story about her that I would love to know more about. If anybody knows more of the story, let me know. But about her waving a bloody flag to inflame a mob against a contingent of militant aristocrats. But she was under threat of arrest at the time, and her parents said, it's important for you to go to America. And of course, there were a lot of Germans coming to America at this time. There was a wave of German refugees fleeing the chaos and kind of brutal tyranny, which was worse after the revolutions than it had been before. But she came here in fear of her life to America. Settled in Mississippi, where she had relatives who were involved in the cotton business down there. She met Julius Ochs probably in Mississippi, probably around Vicksburg, where he had, was making a, trying to make a living as a salesman. They later met in Nashville, and that's where they got married. They were married in Nashville in the early 1850s. They lived in various places, Louisville, Cincinnati, back and forth, but they seemed to settle in Knoxville about 1855, which was a great year to settle in Knoxville. That was the year the railroads arrived, and suddenly Knoxville, the 1850s was a decade that Knoxville tripled in size. And about a lot of the people who moved here, hundreds and hundreds of them, were immigrants from Europe, Switzerland and Germany, and a few from Italy, but these were, and Irish especially, I would warrant a guess that half of the people in Knoxville in the 1850s and 60s had a foreign accent of some kind. They were all new to this place. Julius went into business. Bertha got a job, and they're actually newspaper ads advertising her work in needlepoint. She was teaching needlework and other sewing skills, and from her house, which was on Cumberland Avenue near Market Street. That was where they lived, and that's where she taught sewing. But there was a business dispute reportedly that prompted Julius to leave town around 1857. And Adolph, who may have been conceived in Knoxville, was actually born in Cincinnati. And this is often the only thumbnail descriptions of Adolph Ochs' youth. This is often the only thing you see, is born in Cincinnati, then went to Chattanooga, then went to New York, but it doesn't mention that he was here for so long. The Civil War came along and divided the family, surprisingly. You would not necessarily expect that people from the same ethnic background in Europe would be divided about the Civil War. But Bertha, whose uncles had been prospered in the cotton trade, was sympathetic with the secession, and she actually was a Confederate. That's very strong. Confederate sympathizer during the war. She was in fact arrested for smuggling quinine to the Confederate troops in Kentucky across the Ohio River. Meanwhile, at the same time, her husband, who had been an abolitionist, Julius had been an abolitionist and a Union officer. He was training troops in the Union Army as his wife was providing medical supplies to the Confederate Army. They didn't live together the whole war, it turns out. But in fact, Adolph Ochs rejoined the Army and was ended up down in Knoxville before the war was over in 1864. While he was here, he began working as a businessman and really made a name for himself in Knoxville in a few years. With two such different parents, Adolph, I suspect, may have learned the value of being very careful about what you say and how you say it, because he heard two different, completely different sides of this conflict. Julius brought the divided family back to Knoxville after the war. By this time, there were six kids. Actually, two kids were born. The last two daughters were born here in Knoxville. And this was a city of about 8,000 people. All of them lived downtown, so it was a fairly dense circumstance. In this fairly small town, three combative political parties: the Democrats, the Republicans, and the Radical Republicans, who were as different from the Republicans as the Republicans were from the Democrats. Julius was a Radical Republican. There were partisan gunfights and murders. This was a place of a stew of politics and opportunity and violence at the city. It was a really interesting but sometimes terrifying place to live. There were partisan gunfights and murders in the streets of Gay, even on Gay Street among well-known people. But the Oxes may have witnessed, I'm sure they witnessed a lot of this. Essentially, in such a small town, how many people they knew while they were here. Of course, they knew Parson Brownlow, who was then governor of Tennessee, the most controversial and also the most influential in a positive way governor in Tennessee history. But they also knew Francis Hodgson Burnett, some of them did, the future writer of The Secret Garden, lived here. They also knew William Gibbs McAdoo, who many years later would be, I think, the most influential U.S. Secretary of the Treasury in American history. Also knew E.T. Sanford, who was a young aspiring lawyer at the time. He was later on the U.S. Supreme Court. So these were people in this rather small town that the Oxes, at least some of the Oxes, knew at various times. Julius Ochs got a job selling what he described as citizens and military clothing, but he called it a bazaar. It was just down two blocks down the street, it was known for its green columns. But he had also sold, in the same place he sold clothing, he sold exotic groceries, Limburger cheese, smoked halibut, pickled herring, sardines, and anchovies. This is a place you probably didn't have to keep your eyes open to find. It was a fragrant place, I think. But he did well at that for two or three years, and then actually began building a sort of a palace on Sharps Ridge that he was going to call Oxenburg. This was his aristocratic background coming out a bit, but then came along, a lot of this was based on a wartime shortage economy, and this was suddenly over in 1867, and there was a great a kind of micro depression especially in the textile industry, and he went out of business. He actually declared bankruptcy. Well, by this time he was getting to be very well known in town. He was founding the Hebrew Benevolent Society, which later coalesced into Temple Beth El, as we know it today. They remember Julius Ochs as one of the founders of Temple Beth El. He was sometimes called a cantor or a lay rabbi. He actually conducted services, and he gave public lectures on Judaism, sometimes criticizing Christianity, which he considered a pantheistic religion. And it's remarkable that he gave these public lectures, and they were just discussed in the paper without condemnation. He was also welcomed by Reverend James Park, the Presbyterian minister at First Presbyterian, just a block away, who actually offered the oldest church in town for their use on Saturdays for services for the Jewish congregation. But he joined a lot of other organizations: the Grand Army of the Republic, the GAR, the Union Veterans Organization, Odd Fellows. He was an Odd Fellow, a member of that fraternity. And he also helped found the Turn Verein, which is something remarkable to think about, that a Jewish man would found this German society that was very popular in Knoxville. among German immigrants, and they had German social events, and they even found a Turner's Hall was a Turner Rhyme place where they had they actually hosted operas and some operettas, which Julius Ochs himself wrote some operettas, and he was a creative fellow. The most interesting sounding one was called William and Napoleon, and it was about Wilhelm I and Napoleon III and the Franco-Prussian War, in which he was very strongly siding with the Prussians in the 1870s, and telling telling them why that this ideal of German pride and unity was and a new kind of democracy was important. But this was the same guy that his wife Bertha had rebelled against with the bloody flag and all that 20 years earlier. It's an amazing family. But this was, it was an operetta. It was with music, and it was partly a comic, but it was the newspaper commented on it in positive ways. What else? He was involved in all sorts of things. Besides, when his business didn't work out, he tried lots of other things. He tried to market inventions. He had a fireproof safe and what he called a patent bevel and oil cup. He sold insurance. He worked as a travel agent. He was not only for Europe, he actually was helping people connect with Europe and also bring friends back from Europe, from Germany. If you had a friend in Germany who didn't know how to get to America, he would work it out for you. But he was also a travel agent for the Wild West. He was helping people to get out to Texas at this time, at the time of Billy the Kid and all that. It's fascinating to think that the realm of this guy did not live in one town. He lived across the whole world. He was involved in all sorts of other things, but was also involved in public life. From the very early days he was here in Knoxville, he was on at the convention that nominated Parson Brownlow to be governor of Tennessee in 1865. A very controversial decision by the Unionists of Tennessee when the Civil War was still raging. He was there. He campaigned for Brownlow in 1865. At a time when Brownlow was representing not only stability and the Union victory, but the idea of civil rights and voting rights for black people. But he remained a radical Republican, and was even a delegate to the 1872 Radical Republican Convention that nominated Horace Greeley for President of the United States. What else? He was also elected to public office in Knoxville several times, Justice of the Peace, which was had a special role as it was kind of like a county commissioner, but also with some judicial authority as well. But he in this role he helped build the first permanent bridge across the river after the war. He helped plan a new county jail at this time. So he was a very well-known guy who was doing a lot of stuff for his adopted hometown, he also taught French and German. He spoke several languages, and at night he had a night school teaching French and German to people. So he was kind of helping people connect to their own heritage and also to get used to living in an English-speaking country. Also, this is remarkable. He's the only person I know of in 1860s America who owned in 1860s Knoxville, who owned a guitar. He played guitar, and this was an exotic European instrument at the time. It didn't become popular until the 1890s. In 1860s, Julius Ochs was playing guitar in Knoxville, perhaps with some of his musical shows. Anyway, he was. They were connected to showbiz. That might be then how Adolph Ochs got to be working at Staub's Opera House. He was a very well-known figure. In short, it goes without saying at this point. For 15 years or so, Julius Ochs was one of the leading citizens in Knoxville. I think it's safe to say. Adolph, his firstborn son, was a hardworking student and newspaper employee. He was after Julius Ochs had gone bankrupt, all three of his sons went to work just to help the family. They had never moved into, I'm not sure they were actually moved into Oxenburg on Sharps Ridge, They actually lived in a shotgun shack down on Central, just about two, in fact, about two blocks from where we are right now is where they lived. And the kids had to work as hard as the parents did. But the kids, their first job, all three of the kids, Adolph, Milton, and George, all got jobs as newspaper carriers, and they worked for the Knoxville Chronicle, which was the Republican paper run by William Rule. And William Rule is a really interesting guy in this story. And he's the reason that we're going to dedicate this plaque tomorrow on Market Square. William Rule's Knoxville Chronicle was based on Market Square in the northeast corner of the square. William Rule was a popular Brownlow journalist, but he parted from Brownlow on the idea of objectivity. Brownlow was never objective in a single paragraph in his life as a publisher. But William Rule was remarkably objective. He let people know he was Republican, but he also said nice things about socialists now and then because he was interested in everything and wanted everybody to know the whole story about what they were. What this place we're living in and this era that they were living in. But he was one of the most admirable figures of his era, I think, in retrospect. He was elected mayor twice at Knoxville, wrote the first really substantial history of the city. But he became a mentor to Adolph Ochs, I think first when he was working as a carrier, and then later on as he was working as a typesetter, an apprentice typesetter, they called it a printer's devil. And I've got somewhere, it's in my sack over there, but there's a children's book called the Adolph Ochs Printer's Devil. But he got this job, it was a night shift job, and it would be completely illegal today to have a 14-year-old kid working till midnight in a newspaper office, but that's the job that he got. And William Rule was kind of astonished when at midnight this kid didn't go home. He said, "Can I do something else, Captain Rule?" And he couldn't figure it out. Why isn't this kid going home? He must be tired by now. But he talked to his foreman, whose name was Henry Clay Collins, and he figured it out. He found out that Adolph Ochs didn't want to walk home from his place in Market Square because walking home would be walking by a cemetery, a grave at midnight. He was walking by the Presbyterian Cemetery, which you can still see just a block. You can go there tonight if you want to, if you dare to. But it was this was the same cemetery that he did not want to walk by because his family's house was right below that, and he just didn't want to do that without company, without walking company. He'd wait till Henry Clay Collins got off of his shift and walk with him, or sometimes he would work until dawn. But he said, at least in some after dinner speeches later in his life, that this is how he learned the whole newspaper business, and how when he was the New York Times later on, that he could walk into any room in the Times and tell people what they were doing, and he understood the whole every aspect of the newspaper business better than most publishers do. But after a while, Henry Collins was convinced that he could run a paper himself, and the papers in Knoxville weren't budging. The publishers and editors were keeping their jobs, but he heard that there were some prospects in Chattanooga. And he began talking about wandering down to Chattanooga, where he, in 1879, with some help from some friends, they knew that he was the brains of the outfit. He wasn't the guy that supplied the money to buy the Times, but they worked this out, and he became the publisher of the Chattanooga Times. And I think I might pass the story off here.
That's what I was going to say. We're going to pass the baton to Alex and talk about Mr. Ochs' time in Chattanooga, and then from there to New York.
Well, again, thank you all for coming. I appreciate it. And I know Adolph would be very pleased that you were here. He was a very avuncular, in many respects, a very lovable character. My late wife and I wrote a book about the Ochs and Sulzberger family. And one of the things that we found was that we came to like Adolph Ochs very much and be fascinated by it. Because he became, because of the New York Times largely, he became this kind of iconic figure. A bronze bust in the offices of the New York Times. But that wasn't who the man was at all. He was much more complicated and much more interesting than that. He was also a very conflicted man in many respects, in some respects anyway. In the 1920s, when he was right, when the New York Times had become the kind of iconic newspaper that it is, was, and has been ever since, he got a letter that I found in the New York Times archives when we were doing our research. Adolph did not save letters from fans. He really didn't seem to, I'm sure he enjoyed them, but he didn't save them, or if he saved them, they didn't make it into the New York Times archive. But this letter did, and it was a letter from my great-grandmother, who was the editor of the Greenville Sun at that time. And the letter said, "Mr. Ochs, I have written a column about you in the Greenville Sun, and I am enclosing it." And it was there in the manila folder. And I read it, and I'm paraphrasing, but essentially it said this: "Adolph Ochs is the greatest publisher in America, perhaps in the world. And why this should be is an astonishing mystery, one that I have puzzled over. He left school at 14. He went to work at 11. His father went bankrupt, something that had a profound impact on him because of the humiliation of it. He made a note in a letter that we found about how they even sold the chamber pots. They literally sold everything in the house, and it was a great form of disgrace as far as he was concerned. He said, and he was Jewish to boot, and a Southerner. And in those days, being from the South, this was still during the Reconstruction time, in the aftermath of the, you know, the Civil War, when Adolph Ochs was coming of age, he has overcome that as well to become the greatest editor, the greatest publisher, and the greatest newspaper man in the world, probably, certainly in the United States. And I have puzzled about why this should be. And I feel that I know the answer. His mother." I think what you heard about Julius is true. Julius was a wonderfully idealistic citizen and a very talented man in many ways, but he was not a businessman, and he was not a success, as you could tell from the many jobs he had and the many things he tried. That never worked. He was a good man, a very good man, and his son loved him very much and admired him. Bertha, on the other hand, was a force of nature. She was not just a Confederate married to a Union officer. She insisted on being buried in a Confederate flag, her casket draped in a Confederate flag. And he wrote my great-grandmother back after he had read this column and said, "You are right. She was the making of me." And he said that in his later life in unequivocal terms. Wow. The thing was that Adolph was not the firstborn. He was the secondborn. The firstborn died, and he was adored by his mother and his father. And when Adolph was born, they turned all of that energy, ambition, and hope toward him. And he had Bertha as his afterburner from the get-go. And he was, as you heard, a very industrious guy, a guy with limitless energy, a lot of charm, a persuasiveness, a willingness to work and work and work. And when he went to Chattanooga was a place that is not like what you might expect. Knoxville during the Civil War was a scene of some combat and some strife and battles, but Chattanooga was a real battleground. It was occupied by both armies repeatedly, and by the time the war was over, there was said to be not a tree left standing. The power of Adolph Ochs was that he was willing to put his shoulder to the wheel. And that is what Chattanooga wanted. They were advertising after the war, because Union sympathizers had left when the Southerners occupied it, and Confederates had left when the Union occupied it. It was a city that literally advertised for carpetbaggers, for people who would come and help rebuild Chattanooga. And that's exactly fertile ground for someone like Adolph Ochs. He came there without a lot of money, no money, but with his willingness, his energy, his persuasiveness, and his skills. Highly intelligent, of course, as well, even though uneducated and very sensitive about his lack of formal education for the rest of his life. But he was a success. He created the Chattanooga Times, and he made a success of it. He was a leading citizen of Chattanooga, and he got the idea that in the South there was no anti-Semitism, because even though he was Jewish, he was embraced by Chattanooga and was part of the power structure in Chattanooga, Tennessee. And then he had a gambling streak. He was a guy who wanted to make a fortune. He wanted to make up for those, you know, moments of his father's bankruptcy, and he made some bad speculations and lost a lot of money. And the Chattanooga Times was also having a hard time because of you know, panics of various kinds. And so he realized that the Chattanooga Times could never be the kind of newspaper that would really make his fortune and make his name, because Chattanooga was just too small. What wasn't too small was New York. But he was effectively broke. He had the Chattanooga Times, but it was just on fumes at that time. So he persuaded one of his banker friends, this is how persuasive he was, he persuaded one of his banker friends in Chattanooga to give him a bank account of $5,000 with the promise that he would not write any checks on it. Because he wanted to go to New York, but he didn't want to go to New York with nothing. He didn't want to go to New York with the reality of his having no money. He got this bank account, and he went to New York to try to persuade J.P. Morgan and other titans of industry to let him become proprietor of the New York Times, which was in receivership at that moment. It was in receivership because of the economic plight in the country. This was 1896, and those of you who are historians may remember that that was the year that William Jennings Bryan was preaching the cross of gold, that we will not be crucified on a cross of gold, which was going to mean very bad things for the business side of America. I mean, the people in New York, in other words, like J.P. Morgan and others. But there was not in New York, which was already the financial capital, there was no Democrat newspaper, but William Jennings Bryan was the Democratic nominee. There was no Democratic newspaper in New York City, the sort of the capital of commerce, that was for the gold standard, for keeping the gold standard. So Adolph Ochs presented himself as a conservative Democrat who believed in the gold standard, and there's a lot of I could tell you about how he persuaded these people, basically, on, as they say in the play, Death of a Salesman. He was out there with a smile and a shoe shine, but it worked. He persuaded them that he was the man to take over the New York Times, and they agreed to his terms, which were that after 3 years of profitability, he could acquire and own the New York Times. 4 years later, he did. He owned the New York Times. And on the first day of his ownership of the New York Times, he published those words which have been sort of the emblem of the New York Times ever since. He promised to print the news impartially without fear or favor. The remarkable thing is that that sort of thing was put in publishers', you know, announcements when they took over newspapers almost routinely in the United States. People made that kind of boast that they were going to be fair and impartial. Adolph actually meant it. When he was in Chattanooga, the Chattanooga Times adopted a policy of political neutrality. Now that was, in one way, self-serving, because as a Jew and as a guy who was in an environment with many different political streams, he was a man of peace. He did not want anybody to be his enemy. He wanted everybody to be his friend. When he got the New York Times, he didn't even want to have an editorial page, but he was persuaded he had to. He had an editorial page, but the thing he did that was very much Adolph Ochsian was that he published page after page of letters to the editor, many of which disagreed with what was in the New York Times. So the idea that the New York Times has not been subject all along to criticism is simply not true. I mean, but Adolph really understood that one of the best things you can do is let people have their say. Let people speak. He was a conservative. He was a Democrat. But he published so many letters to the editor. For instance, he was against women's suffrage. The New York Times opposed women's suffrage. But he published so many letters from people who were pro-women's suffrage that when it passed, they sent him a letter thanking him for allowing the New York Times to be this, basically this platform for that kind of information that essentially led to the suffrage happening. He was a brilliant promoter. He was not this was the day of the Yellow Press. Pulitzer, the Yellow Kid, William Randolph Hearst, they were all there. And Adolph, his aspiration was that the New York Times would be the business newspaper. And he got himself in trouble in the sense that he was catering to the business, community. He did things, innovative things, right off the bat. He increased the size of the type so it was easier to read. He knew a lot about typography from his time in Knoxville and Chattanooga and made it look better. But he, at the time of the Spanish-American War, he supported the war. But when the war broke out, business shut down. Wall Street shut down. And Wall Street was the principal vehicle for the advertising at that time that was in the New York Times. And Adolph was in a state of collapse because it looked like the New York Times very easily might go under. And then he had one of his brilliant strokes of genius. It was later basically depicted as. It wasn't quite that because the circumstances made it more of a necessity than a virtue. But the point is, the quality press in New York, like the Sun and the Herald and the Tribune and the Times, cost 3 cents. Pulitzer and Hearst papers cost 1 cent. He unilaterally cut his sales price to 1 cent. When that happened, his circulation increased. When that happened, his advertising increased, and he was on his way. He was a great promoter and very inventive at it. I mean, for instance, it was his idea on the new Times building in Times Square, named for the New York Times, to have a ball drop from the building on New Year's Eve. It still does, as you know. That is Adolph Ochs's New York Times building that he built shortly after he became owner of the New York Times. He also did something that is really fascinatingly, incredibly smart to me. It's something that probably none of you are familiar with, but you are familiar with Google. So this was the first version of Google. The New York Times, at his direction, began printing a cotton version of the New York Times. Now, what that means is that instead of being made from wood pulp, it would last much longer, be much more endurable. At the same time, he had hired his employees to create an index of everything that appeared in the New York Times. Every name, every event, every date, and publish it in an index that was effectively a searchable database, the very first one for public, for public information about current events. The newspaper, this rag newspaper that was something that would endure, was bought by libraries all over the United States, so that they would also buy the New York Times index, and that people who were looking to find out what happened about anything would go to the index, look up the article, look up the name, look up the date, go to the newspaper, which the library also had because they subscribed, and find this information. And that's why the New York Times came to be known as the newspaper of record. It was this vehicle that made it possible to search for and find reliable information about what had happened on any subject, on treaties, on dates, on wars, on whatever. He also was a man who had his weaknesses. He was a Jew. And this was something that was very, very important to him, and something that he was very sensitive about, but something that he came to feel that he had misunderstood. He told his wife that he never felt like he ran into anti-Semitism until he came to New York. He'd never experienced it in Chattanooga. And he had the idea that Chattanooga and the South were not anti-Semitic. And then came the Leo Frank case. Some of you may be familiar with that. This is a case in Atlanta, 1912, when a Jewish factory owner was accused of murdering a little girl named Mary Fagan. And the fact that he was Jewish and she was a little girl who was not Jewish basically created a kind of notoriety and this incredible hysteria in the South was whipped up about this Jew killing this little girl. And he was convicted and sentenced to death. The New York Times, under the direction of Adolph Ochs, who did not, remember, he was not a crusading guy. He did not crusade about anything, but he crusaded about this. He crusaded to save Leo Frank's life. And largely through the efforts of Adolph Ochs, Leo Frank's death sentence was reversed by the governor of Georgia, and he was given life instead, life in prison instead. But not long after that, a group of prominent Atlanta citizens, in a well-organized, police-sanctioned effort, broke into the jail and lynched Leo Frank. This absolutely devastated Adolph Ochs. It devastated him because he realized that the New York Times intervention is one of the things that had whipped up the anti-Frank sentiment and had prompted, maybe prompted, or at least certainly was used as a reason for lynching Leo Frank. He went into a depression, and he stayed in that depression for a number of years. All the time, the New York Times was doing what he had pledged to do, reinvesting, hiring more reporters, publishing more stories, doing things like the index, becoming the paper of record. He was coming out of his depression in the 1920s. And in the 1920s were probably his happiest time, because the Times was doing brilliantly, and he was a rich man all of a sudden. He didn't live like a rich man for many, many years after he acquired the Times. He slept 5 hours a night. He worked all the time. That's the kind of person he was. But by then, he was, you know, older. He was in his 60s and even, you know, 70s. And he loved his daughter, Iphigenie, and he loved his life there in New York, and he loved the success of the New York Times, and he loved being the recipient of things like what my great-grandmother had sent him, calling him the greatest publisher in America. And then something else happened that put him back into a depression from which he really never recovered, and this was the rise of Adolf Hitler. Mm-hmm. He was German. He had German relatives. And he, in 1933, when Hitler was elected chancellor, he knew what Hitler was. He hadn't been aware of Hitler before then. But when he was elected chancellor of Germany and the laws against Jews began to be enacted, it sent him into a really sharp decline. He died in 1935. His successor was his one daughter and one child's husband, Arthur Hayes Sulzberger. And Arthur Hayes Sulzberger became head of the Times, and the Times went on from there. What would Adolph Ochs think of the New York Times since he left it? I think he would be proud of several things in particular. One was that the New York Times, under Arthur Hayes Sulzberger, was one of the newspapers that strongly supported intervention in World War II. The isolation period of the late 30s and early, you know, before Pearl Harbor was very, very strong. And Adolph Ochs would have wanted the Times to be on the side of giving relief to anything that would counter Adolf Hitler. He also would have been very proud, I think, of the Pentagon Papers. The Pentagon Papers, that was under his grandson, Punch Sulzberger, who published these documents that proved that the government had been lying. It was lying about Vietnam, and it was a very significant watershed for American journalism, because it was, even though the New York Times was the most establishment of newspapers, it was not unafraid to publish the truth without fear or favor, even if it was something that the president tried very hard to keep him from doing. And it went to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court said that the president could not stop. And that's what happened. That, I think, would have been a source of great pride for him. But I do know that this environment we're in now, with the partisan anger and so forth, he would have wanted very much to try to be a vehicle for healing that. He was a man, as I say, a man of peace. But he would have had to figure out how to do that, and who knows, nobody has figured it out yet. The one thing I am absolutely certain of that he would have been more proud of and more satisfied with than absolutely anything else is that today, his great-great-grandson heads the New York Times, and two other great-great-grandsons are senior executives there, and that his family has not only owned but has run the New York Times for 125 years, and it is still the preeminent newspaper that he wanted it to be. That, I know, he would have cared deeply about. Thank you very much.
We'd like to open it up for any kind of questions or comments that anybody might have.
Yeah, a number of years ago when I was doing research for a New Year's Eve event, and found out about the organization. origins of the ball drop. I guess it replaced fireworks, which were threatening to burn down a large portion of the Times Square. So stop for that, and we had to switch to the ball drop. But one of the things I saw that I thought was really interesting was it said that in the first month, I'm assuming after he got involved at the time, maybe after he owned it, that in the first month he changed the slogan, all the news is fit to print, which Jack could tell you the origin of, and started the Book Review, the Sunday magazine, and I'd heard this thing I saw. So he actually, at that point, differentiated himself from the other kind of yellow journalist newspaper by increasing the price from 1 cent to 2 cents originally to make it stand out. And I hadn't heard the part about him later dropping it.
Well, yeah. Yes, he was very, in the first, you know, blush of his proprietorship, that was when he published his statement. He was in charge.
Yeah.
He didn't own it, but he was in charge of it. He did all kinds of things like that. In the Week in Review, that was another one of his innovations. He, you know, the Pulitzer and Hearst were doing all these stunts, and he did stunts too. But his stunts were of a different nature. He did stunts like Admiral Peary to the North Pole. You know, he, you know, they sponsored Peary. They didn't sponsor, you know, somebody sitting on a flagpole. But he was a very, very innovative, creative, and bombastically promotional guy. He believed in that. He had a competition for the slogan. The one that he liked and that he wrote himself was All the News It's Fit to Print. The one that won the award was All the News and Won't Soil the Dinner Table or the Breakfast. He didn't like that, so he declared that may be the winner, but that's not going to be the slogan. And All the News That's Fit to Print, that's again, that was Adolph. And he was a, you know, he was a man who had a sense of humor, a sense of warmth. He adored his daughter and would take her out for long walks on weekends and things like that. He was a doting father and a man who was very, very deeply connected with his extended family. I'm very glad some members of the Ox family are here, because he was a man who embraced his family wholeheartedly and broadly. He had a number of brothers and sisters, as well as, of course, related people through his cousins and to his father and mother and so forth. But he was very, very attached to his family and that. But that said, he was never willing to let the Times, not the New York Times, I mean, not be something that stayed in the family, and that meant in his direct descendants' family, even though the sort of the popular thought is that the Times is owned by the Sulzbergers. No, it's owned by the Oxes, who also happen to be the Sulzbergers. But he was a man who stayed very close and very attached to his family throughout his life, and they to him. Of course, he was the big enchilada. No question about that. Yes.
There's a couple of things. Between Knoxville and Chattanooga, and actually spent a little bit of time in Louisville, Kentucky, too, and kind of in this area, it seems like it set the foundation for his philosophy of what is good, strong journalism. And I think his roots were here, Chattanooga, and in Louisville. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think he spent a little time in Louisville hoping to grow and progress there, and he saw that he didn't have any growth potential there, so he left.
Well, New York was about to be the second biggest city in the world, and he realized that you make money from a newspaper in a big market, not in a small market. Mm. Now, he had relatives on his father's side, his mother's side too, maybe, on that, in Louisville. But he, it didn't work out. So he decided to go to a place where he could have a newspaper. And that's what he thought he could do and run a newspaper in Chattanooga. Now, you ask about what the significance, especially of his Knoxville experience was for the formation of his philosophy. I think the thing that sums that up best is what he wrote on the eve of his departure for Chattanooga. And it was a quote from Othello. It was the quote that said, effectively, if I don't have my good name, I have nothing. Mm-hmm. It was a matter of pride. It was a matter of his having a sense that he had something to prove. Something to prove, but to prove honorably, that would enhance his stature and his good name. I think that he wanted to succeed. I am sure his ambition was ferocious. But he also had a kind of understanding that what really mattered more to him than anything was that he be admired and respected, and that he, if you will, if you want to be Freudian about it, that he escape that sense of embarrassment that his father's bankruptcy and his, you know, people, you know, I'm sure he ran into some kind of anti-Jewish sentiment, his lack of education, things that he felt like he had to overcome. I think that's what got him going. And I think his mother really pushed him.
Question over here? No.
If you were the helm of the New York Times today, what do you think you would do?
Well, you know, that's an interesting question. I was asking myself that as I was thinking about this tonight. I don't know. I mean, he would be, you know, the world changed. As I say, he was against women's suffrage. Where would his politics be now? I think the thing that would have happened that would have been most upsetting to him and would have guided his direction of the New York Times was when the New York Times and journalists in general, were described by the President of the United States as the enemy of the people. Mm-hmm. That, I think, would have absolutely enraged him and would have also been something that would have been for him a call to arms. Because if anything, he was a man who adored his American heritage and felt grateful to America and was a very, very patriotic man. I mean, his father named his younger brother when he was born George Washington. I mean, that's the kind of family they were. And I think that he would have been someone who adored America as so many immigrants do and did. He was one of those. And I think that his guidance would have been about being what he perceived to be the role of the New York Times, to report the news without fear or favor.
I've got a question over here and then I'll come back. Go ahead.
Jack, I found it interesting, you were talking about his father and mother, his father coming from an aristocratic background, his mother coming from an anti-aristocratic background, and then coming to the United States, and she becomes a diehard Confederate, and he becomes a Northern sympathizer. And I just wonder if you could, either anyone on the panel could explain those shifts, and also what
maybe she was just a rebel by nature, whatever you got, you know, like James Dean, what, yeah, or Marlon Brando, I think it is. Yeah, it says, what do you got? That's an interesting puzzle. I don't really know the answer. She was outspoken. They were both her parents were outspoken and had their own strong opinions, and that's and I think that he saw both of those opinions and learned to learned to talk to both of his parents, and they, it was a loving family, and they would not have stayed together if, with all these divisions if they were not. And it's amazing that as soon as he was a success in Chattanooga, he hired his family to come down and work with him down there. So it's a, you know, I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
Well, I think that he knew that both his mother and his father were highly principled people based on their own sets of prejudices and beliefs. Mm-hmm. His father was an abolitionist. His mother was from a slave-owning family. She never lost that sense of her heritage, being a deep Southerner. She was a Mississippian. I mean, she was in her heart a Mississippian. And as I say, was buried in a casket draped with the stars and bars. And the fact that she loved her husband, stayed with him, and I honestly believe she admired him greatly, but she was frustrated because he was not a success in a worldly way. Adolph, she wanted to be an unquestioned success, and that's why when her older son died, Adolph basically got all that attention and all that sort of, you know, motivation, if you will. I don't know why her father, his father was an abolitionist, but my guess is because he was a sort of philosophical Jewish intellectual, and that was the way he saw the world. He thought slavery was wrong, and she thought slavery was none of his business, I think.
I think we have time for one more question. There's two there, so let's start here, and then we'll go back.
To that, a broader question, are we slouching back toward the 19th century values in journalism? Because in the 19th century, newspapers didn't try to be objective. They were partisan until about the time of Adolph Ochs. He wasn't the only one that presented this idea of objectivity, but I think he was the most powerful one and the most persuasive, most influential one. But is that happening again? Are we going to remember the 20th century as that time that we had objective journalism?
Well, the organization that is sponsoring this, along with University of Tennessee, is an organization of professional journalism. That was the preeminent and still is the largest organization that espouses professional journalism, which espouses a set of ethics and a criteria of objectivity and fairness. Now, the problem is that sometimes there's only one side to a story. I mean, look at Nazi Germany. This was one of the Adolph Ochs' difficult experiences. He was violently anti-Hitler. Violently, he was hugely depressed. He was dismayed, horrified. But there were a lot of people that read the New York Times in New York who were fans of Adolph Ochs, I mean of Adolf Hitler. And they used to send letters to the editor. And Adolph Ochs's policy was you print them all. Well, he couldn't bear to print pro-Hitler letters to the editor. So he banned all letters to the editor involving Nazism and Adolf Hitler. That was his solution. That's no solution. You know, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I think that he turned himself into a pretzel in order not to have to do something that he found reprehensible, which would have been his newspaper publishing pro, you know, Adolf Hitler letters or information. When I was the editor of the Greenville Sun, the Ku Klux Klan picketed the Greenville Sun. I thought, what the hell is this? I came home from lunch one day, I came back to the office from lunch, and I thought, is there a circus in town? Honestly. And it was the Ku Klux Klan picketing the Greenville Sun because I would not allow them to advertise in the Greenville Sun. And so they picketed us. And I sent a photographer and a reporter out to do a news story about the fact that they were angry at the Greenville Sun because we would not let them advertise. And I explained in the course of that story why I would not allow the Greenville Sun's pages to be used to validate the Ku Klux Klan. And that's the way I dealt with it. I think the point is that these are hard times because people feel very passionately, and they feel very passionately opposite things. I don't know, of course, what Adolph Ochs would think about anything in particular. I think he would have been horrified by January 6th. I think it would have scared him to death. And I think that that would have been something that would have been like a watershed moment for him. But of course, I don't really know. I do know that to avoid printing anything positive about Hitler, he closed his letters to the editor pages to that subject, which meant there were no anti-Hitler letters either.
One last question.
Can't hear you.
It's about the influence of Tennessee politics, and how did that affect his growth and understanding of politics
during Reconstruction, right?
Yeah,
back during Reconstruction.
Well, he was trying very hard to thread that needle that made nobody mad at him in particular. So he was that's where his impartiality, the impartiality aspect of his, background started in Chattanooga. That's where he declared that the Chattanooga Times was going to be impartial because, of exactly the violence of, as you were describing, what Knoxville was like, Chattanooga was too. And there was a great deal of passionate feeling. And so the only way he could thrive as a business and not get, not antagonize everybody, was to give everybody a voice. And that was the way he solved that. And he did that by being impartial. Impartial politically, impartial in coverage. That doesn't mean, I'm sure, that he didn't get, furious complaints by people who said he wasn't being impartial if he published something that they didn't like. That's the way nature makes us, I'm afraid. But he also had this knack, very funny, to read his responses to people who would write these absolutely blood-curdling, threatening, notes. And he would respond, "Thank you for your helpful thought." That was his nature.
Thank you very much. Maria is going to kind of give us some closing comments here.
What a tremendous panel. Thank you. I had to step out to do an interview with WATE during the event, and I'm an editor by trade, so I say very few words. I take words out of everything, and I told them the topic of it. What would Adolph Ochs think of the current state of the media? My answer was, less noise, more news. Y'all explained
an editor speaking
much better than that. We are now, any media that would like to talk to the panelists, you certainly can interview them here. I also have talking points in the media release if you need it for media who are writing about this event. I want to remind everyone that tomorrow at noon, 36 Market Square on Wall Avenue, we will unveil the historic plaque that was granted by SPJ that officially, there's only two in Tennessee, Knoxville will be the second, that officially will honor in perpetuity Adolph Ochs' connection to Knoxville and the fact his newspaper career started here. So if you can attend that, everyone's welcome to the public. Bernadette and Scott West have been delightful. They're going to have coffee and water and some food for people, and then we'll have a program. The mayor of Knoxville, India Kincannon, will be here, and we'll present a proclamation that will help us unveil the plaque tomorrow. Tonight, we're going to do what journalists do best. We're going to go get something to drink and some food on Market Square at Bernadette's Crystal Garden. It is right literally down Market Square. You'll see it's kind of purplish looking, I think, from the outside. It is, according to Jack, basically a few hundred feet from where his office was.
Actually, maybe a few feet. I wouldn't say a few hundred feet. It's very close to it. The descriptions say it was on the east side of Market Square near Asylum, which is what these call Wall Avenue. And where Burnett's is the oldest single building on Market Square, and it was there when Adolph Ochs and William Rule and the Knoxville Chronicle were there. Whether it was that building or not, we're not absolutely sure, but I think it was probably next to it or something. But it's an authentic building that Adolph Ochs walked by hundreds of times. So.
Well, everybody is welcome to join us there to raise a toast to journalism and the hard work that journalists here in Knoxville do every single day. I think Adolph Ochs would approve of the way Knoxville goes about its business. So you're welcome to us. I also want to recognize Jennifer Ellis. She's Region 12 Coordinator for SBJ, which includes Tennessee. And Lou Perry is here. He is the editor of SBJ 12 magazine. We so appreciate national SBJ people and regional people coming to Knoxville to join us for this event. So thank you. And should I say go Vols here?
Yeah, sure. Alex, thank you very much.
My pleasure.
That was wonderful. Jack, thank you.
Thanks, appreciate it.